Okay, so good morning, everybody. Good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are. Welcome to this PEP skill seminar this morning or afternoon. Veronica Amarante will be presenting today gender differences in housework and income, intra-household evidence from Latin America. Veronica is a professor at the Instituto de Economía at the Universidad de la República in Uruguay, and her areas of research are development economics, labor market, social protection, gender inequality, and poverty. So she will be presenting for around 30 minutes, more or less, and after that we will have some time for questions. So we request you to, if you have any questions, to ask them in the Q&A box. There's also the chat box, but we prefer the Q&A, but wherever you want to post your question is fine. So Veronica, welcome. You can, do you want to share your screen? You're muted now.
Okay, thank you very much, Carmen.
You can make it bigger, the presentation too.
Yes, thank you. Okay, good morning or good afternoon to everyone. Thank you for attending this seminar. And thank you, Pep, for the opportunity of sharing this work with you. What I'm presenting is joint work with Cecilia Rossell. And as Carmen said, it's about gender differences in housework and earnings. And we provide evidence for Latin American countries. So what is our main motivation? Basically, we know some things about Latin American households. First of all, that gender inequality in time dedicated to housework is higher than in the developed world. There is a substantial difference. And we also have a particular characteristics of the labor markets in Latin America, and it's that women are excluded from paid work, still excluded from paid work in a significant proportion. So in this context, what we are trying to do is to understand how existing theories about housework and earnings apply to more unequal contexts like the ones in the Latin American countries. And we specifically want to consider the intra-household relationship between earnings and houseworks using time-use surveys for 5 Latin American countries, which are Chile, Colombia, Mexico, Peru, and Uruguay. So what does the theory say about the relationship between earnings and housework? Well, there are competing theories. One hypothesis is that what matters in this relationship is relative resources. So this is called the dependency theory, and basically the idea is that the partner with lower earnings compensates the other by doing more housework in the household. So the underlying idea in all cases is that housework is something that people don't like, so everybody, both women and men, try to escape from housework. And there is something there related to the kind of tasks included in housework. I will explain that later. But then resources hypothesis or the dependency theory, what basically does is to test the role of relative earnings, female over male earnings. And there is another explanation which has been widely tested for European countries, basically, and is known as gender displays or gender deviance. And basically, the idea is that individuals with relative earnings that are high, very high or very low for their gender compensate by exaggerating their gender normative housework. So it's like people tend to reinforce their gender identities through housework. Somehow this is like a break in the logic of economic exchange performance. There are other factors that are mainly, we can say, sociological, and that explain behavior about housework within the couple. And so this is empirically, this is tested through the considering, again, relative earnings, female or the share of female earnings in total household earnings, in total couple earnings, or the square of relative earnings to see if there is, as I said, if there is some kind of deviance in the upper part of the distribution, or there are other ways of testing this, for example, the intersection between female earnings and a binary variable if women are more. So there is a lot of also of evidence for some countries, some European countries on this gender display hypothesis. And the last one is what is called the autonomy hypothesis. And basically the idea is that what determines the amount of time that people devote to housework is their own income. So the amount of time that women devote to housework will depend on her own incomes and not her partner's income. It's assuming that every additional dollar that a woman earns matters more to decisions about her the time that she will devote to housework than any additional dollar earned by her partner. In empirical terms, this is tested through absolute female earnings and absolute male earnings in logs or in splines. There are different forms of trying to test this, and there is also evidence about for some countries, specific countries, and in this case it's the US, about the importance of own earnings. So in Latin America, we have, as I said, Latin American countries began to collect time use surveys some years ago, and there is some literature derived from this data, but it's mainly descriptive, and it has not addressed, basically it has not addressed the link between earnings and housework. In a previous work with my co-author, we find that unpaid work in the region is much more responsive to personal household characteristics, to female personal household characteristics, and also that informal jobs are associated more time dedicated to unpaid work for women. There is the pattern is different, is weaker for men. So if the link between informal paid work and housework is also something that has to improve. So there are two other papers, one from Campagna and co-authors, to find a result with the idea that working mothers choose self-employment as a way to improve work and life balance. So again, it's not exactly the same as informality, as the definition of informality in the previous paper, but it's the same idea of a job with a relatively bad working conditions, because in Latin America, the major part of self-employment has that characteristics. And then, In this other paper from Dominguez and Amoros, they evaluate the factors that explain the gender gap in the distribution of unpaid domestic work, and they find that the role of economic resources is limited to understand the gender gap. So this last one, that is a recent paper from this year, they do something similar to what we are doing, and they find no important effects. Our data we used as a set time use surveys from these five countries. It is important to note that in all cases, these are several questions and it's not time-there information. And there is a lot of discussion about the quality of these survey questions and how they compare to the information that is collected through that information. Basically, in Latin America, all data about time use comes from these time use surveys. It's mainly a question of costs, of the costs of collecting the data. It's cheaper, these surveys are cheaper than direct information. When the results for developed countries, when they were able to compare the two ways of collecting information, results do not differ. Do not have very big differences, but it's true that they are more precise with that information. It's also important to note that, as I said, these surveys have not been used a lot, so there are still some problems related to the quality of the information. In all cases, in this service that we chose, the data was collected as a special model of a traditional household service. So we have the information about time use, and we have all the other traditional information for the household that is collected through household service. And in all cases, except in the case of Uruguay, information was obtained from the corresponding person. And this is also important because in the case of Uruguay, we have that, for example, most of the respondents were women. I think it's around 90% were women, but they respond, these women respond about men's time use. And this is not the same in the other countries. It's a better option in the other countries because each person can answer about his or her time use. So we are restricting our analysis to cohabiting partners with at least one child and age between 25 and 64. Here we have the sample sizes of the survey in persons and in households, and in the red circles I have marked what the part of the sample that we are considering. So it goes from 20% of households in Chile and around 50% in more than 50%, sorry, in Peru. So this depends on household composition. And so we are taking a subsample of these surveys, and as I said before, and you have there the types of household. An important characteristic is that we have in all these countries we have a very high percentage of these couples are only male earnings couples, so with zero female earnings, and this is around half of the couples in Mexico and Peru, and even in Chile and Uruguay, when only male earnings are lower, there are around 37%. It's a very high percentage. Then we have what we call dual earners. As you can see, it's the other important category, and we define dual earners as equal sharing when women earn between 45% or 55% of the couple's earnings. And then it's evident that female breadwinner households are the minority. The highest percentage is in Uruguay, and it's around 15% within these couples that we are considering for the analysis. So how do we test our hypothesis? To test we first consider a specification that allows to see the dependency and the gender deviance theory. In that equation, the dependent variable is time dedicated to housework, and the X are the share of female earnings, or the share of female earnings, the square share of female earnings, and the Z variables are controls, and we include there, I will show you later, but we include personal and and household characteristics. And then in a second step, what we do is we add absolute male and female earnings. In that case, is the equation that I'm showing is the one for females, because these equations are estimated for male and for females. And we add absolute women earnings to see what happens to the coefficients for the dependency or the gender deviance hypothesis. And finally, we test, given our results in the previous steps that I will show you later, we test the autonomy hypothesis considering the role of male and female absolute earnings. So as I said, the dependent variable is the absolute number of housework hours per person within a household. And here it is important that what I'm presenting here is a wide definition of housework, because it includes the traditional tasks as cooking, shopping, cleaning, washing, but we also include the childcare. There is a discussion in the literature, because childcare has a different nature, and also it's possible that people enjoy the time dedicated to childcare, or at least enjoy that task more than the other ones. But we also did our estimations excluding childcare, and the main results do not change. The variables, the control variables include the characteristics of both members of the couple, partner's age, own and partner's age, non-labor income, education. And also we include the presence of other adults in the household that may help with housework. And if the household pays for domestic work, if there is outsourcing of domestic work, and the number of children at different ages. And our estimations, I mean, in our case, the dependent variable has a relatively high proportion of individuals that report that they dedicate no time to unpaid household work. And this is higher among men. And so we run both Tobit and OLS regressions. There is also a discussion about which of these, how different are Tobit and OLS regressions for this kind of estimations, and basically the results do not change a lot. We have also the Tobit estimations, but I'm presenting the OLS. So before I go on, our main problem, and probably you have all already noticed, is that the endogeneity problem, because we have reverse causality, or time spent in housework may affect women's and men's earnings. And in our case, traditional methods to deal with endogeneity are hard to implement because of our data. We have all cross-sectional data for different countries. So now we are trying to improve our estimation. What I'm presenting is what we have finished as finished work, but we are still working on these issues. In that paper of Connelly and Kimmel, they instrument wages through a standard first step procedure to reduce endogeneity problems, but not to completely solve them. There are other papers which have tried to deal with it through the estimation of simultaneous equations, using shock characteristics to identify wages, or the estimation of structural equations to stage regressions. But as I said, at this stage, we have not tried to solve this problem. So I will show you some of the results. Some of the descriptive results. There you have the frequencies of the distribution of unpaid of minutes of unpaid work. In the first row it's Chile, and in the last one it's Uruguay. And we have women to the left and men to the right. And it's obvious that it's a completely different distribution of the dependent variable with the mode much to the left in the case of men. In the other countries, it's very similar what we find. And before I go into more detail into our results, let me show some descriptive evidence. There we have the ratio of time dedicated to housework between women and men. So it's more time women devote to housework. And what we see in all cases, of course, it's a higher time devoted to housework by women, but there are important differences depending on the types of household. In the second bar corresponds to both parents working, so it's dual earners couples. And if you look at that, we have that in Chile, dual earners couple, women in dual earners couples dedicate twice the double of time that men to housework, and in Uruguay that is three times, and something similar is in Mexico and in Peru, and the highest gaps are in Colombia. So in all cases, for dual earners, we will be between two and three more times in the case of women. Just to have a comparison, in the case of the Nordic countries, when they compare among dual earners, this ratio is around 1.2. And in other European countries, it's like 1.5 or 1.7, depending on the country, but it's on that range. So we have a considerable higher, even among dual earners, we consider higher gaps. Of course, when we look at a household where only the husband works, those are the biggest differences. And I said that is still important in Latin America. Half of the of our sample is of this subsample of couples is in that condition, only male earners. So here we have what we have here is the average time that men and women devote in each of the countries to housework, and in the horizontal axis we have the share of female earners in ventiles, mobile ventiles. So the red lines like are almost horizontal for the five countries in the lowest part of the graph is the time that men devote, which clearly is much less responsive to the share of female earnings that in the case of women. In the case of women, that is the blue lines, blue and green lines, they are clearly decrease with the share of female earnings, and this is like some preliminary evidence. We have a similar path when you consider male absolute earnings instead of the female share, men or women absolute earnings, the graph are very similar and but are not so clear in the case of men's earnings. So what do we have? And I'm aware that this is like can be hard to look at the table. It's not very, very pretty, but let me show you. We have like three parts of the results. In the first corresponds to the first equation that I showed when we included only female share and female share squared. And in the second row we included I added female absolute earnings in logs, and then female absolute earnings in splines, three splines in the last part of the table. Instead of considering the log of female earnings, we consider three splines corresponding to 0, 50 percentile, then between 50 and 90, and more than 90. And well, what are our results? When we only consider a female share or female share square, and all these regressions are with all the other controls that I mentioned, that of course I cannot present here, but we have controls for education, for ages of both partners in the in the couple, for the presence of other adults, for the presence of children in the household and the age of the children, and also for the presence of paid domestic work. So that is all included in the regressions, but I can't show you everything here. But when we only consider the female share, we have like some evidence of that may be consistent with the gender display hypothesis for women in Peru and Colombia. And because there we have the negative coefficient for female share of earnings, but then it turns positive in a very high, in the upper tail of the share of the female share of earnings, and it's in a very high relative point. It's like above 90%. But we have that evidence, and in the other countries, we will say that it's their relative earnings, the female share, it's in all cases it's significant and with expected size. And in the case of men, it's not so clear. We have that relative earnings are not significant for men in Colombia or in Mexico. So in the second, as I said, in a second step, we added female share, female and share of earnings in the equations. At what we have is that for in Mexico, in Peru, the display hypothesis that seemed to be significant in the previous estimation disappears, but it remains in Colombia. And as a third estimation, if instead of considering the level of earnings, we consider it in splines, that is something that it's done in the most recent literature, we find that the display hypothesis disappears. And what is significant is women's earnings, and specifically women's earnings in the medium of the distribution, in the 15-90%. So this was our first results. Then this is similar to an exercise presented in papers like Gupta for United States and Australia, and Hook also in another recent paper for I think it's for United States, that the idea that when the evidence of the gender deviance that may appear even in developing countries tends to disappear when you also include the female the absolute female earnings. And then what we did is that we concentrated then in the autonomy hypothesis, as these first results tended to indicate that what was important were the absolute earnings. So we tried to concentrate on absolute earnings here, and what we have is that clearly female absolute earnings, as I said, both in terms of logs or in splice, are determinants of housework. When women earn more, they tend to dedicate less time to housework. In the case of men, their own earnings do not affect their own time dedicated to housework. Only in the third spline, in the very upper time of the distribution, you have in some countries, for example, in Chile and in Colombia, you have some significant coefficient. But the general pattern is that for men, their own earnings do not affect or are not correlated with the time devoted to housework, but in the case of women, yes. So what we did, I mean, I'm here trying to give you like an idea of what we did. There we have all the models that we estimated, because I chose and I presented you some of the regressions, but we estimated relative earnings, relative and absolute, with different specification, etc. We have these seven models, and what we tried is to see which were the best models in terms of some criteria, informational criteria, and in as you see, we consider Akaike and Bayesian criteria for to select among the specifications, and the blue squares are the best specification according to for each country and for male and women according to to the Aikaiki criteria and the green ones to, according to the Bayesian criteria. And what we tend to, if you look at the table, what we tend to find is that best specifications always include absolute earnings. In some cases, include absolute earnings and relative earnings, but in other only relative earnings. So this like tends to confirm the absolute earnings hypothesis, or that the best way to understand this relationship is considering own earnings and not so much the relative earnings or the share of female earnings within the couple. And so just to end, because I know I'm near the time, just to tell you what we are now working on. As I said, we are trying to improve our specifications in to control for endogeneity, but we are also trying to, for some of the countries, we can look at weekdays and weekends separately. And so there is previous evidence that finds that there are differential patterns of housework in weekends and weekdays. Basically, what they all tend to find is that the strong negative relationship between women's employment or women's earnings, that is something similar to what we find, holds on weekends, but not necessarily on weekdays, but not necessarily on weekends. And there is also evidence, as I said, from Hook and from this other paper for Canada, that they found they underline the importance of considering separately weekdays and weekdays. So here, what I just to give you an idea, we are working on this, that and here what we have is the share of female earnings on weekdays and on weekends, and clearly the time devoted to housework by women is declining with the share of earnings on weekdays, and this was similar to what we saw previously. But when you consider weekends, this is not so. It's like much more flat the curve. So we are working on that now. All the previous evidence was average days of the week, as it's usual in the literature, because this separation is like more recent. So we are now trying to disentangle this. So, the basic conclusions that the evidence that is compatible with dependency or even with gender variance neutralization tends to disappear when we include absolute earnings in the models, and the best specification to understand intra-household decisions about housework includes always female absolute earnings, so it's more consistent with the autonomy hypothesis. For men, we do not find a clear pattern of association with their own earnings, with their own earnings or with their partner earnings. And also, it's evident that changing the unequal distribution of unpaid time within couples is not compatible with the high rates of dependency in terms of earnings. For the case of women in Latin America, this means with the low rates of participation that still prevail in Latin American countries. And well, as I said, we have the open question about differential patterns for weekdays and weekends. So that was my presentation. We can have some, hopefully some comments or questions, and thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Veronica. For the attendees, please post your questions or comments on the Q&A box. In case you have any. So I have a question, which is not maybe directly related to the specific work you're doing, but to the data that you're using. How's the quality of the time use household service in Latin America and Do you think it has been improving, or do you have any comments on that?
Yes, I think there are problems with the quality of this data. And even in Uruguay, we have problems. I don't know if you noticed that I used the 2007 survey mm-hmm. and not the last one, because the last one, you cannot use it for micro estimations because of some problems of the data. So and Uruguay is like a good country in terms of the quality of the service. So we have some problems there, but also what is like reassuring is that the patterns are so similar between countries. The big figures are very similar between countries, and you don't find strange things. And that's so I think that some aggregate things can be reasonably studied with this study, with these surveys. The problem is that when you try to go to a very specific thing that, you know, you see nice papers in Europe looking at this or that specific task or something like that, and then there you have problems and it's no, but for the aggregation, for example, housework or childcare as aggregate variables, you can look at that.
Okay. Yeah. And what about multitasking? Is it considered in this?
That is another problem because you have multitasking in these equations in these surveys, and yes, you can't control for that. And what we did, I did not show that, but in some specific cases, we censor the data in the upper because you can't have a lot. A huge amount of housework, and so we have to do some treat the data in that sense. There is a question there that it says how to compare your results with results from rich countries. Is there a more equal division of work in the households between men and women? What we find in Latin American countries is a more unequal division of housework within the household. So a clearly much more unequal. This is in part because a high percentage of households are only male earnings households. And so there you have very big gaps because women do not work and dedicate a lot, but really all day to housework. But even if you restrict the comparison to dual earnings household, somehow it's like household where both members of the couple are working, you have higher gaps, like between two and three times more time dedicated to housework by women, whereas in the European countries, this is 1.5 or even 1.2 in the Nordic countries. So it's a big, we have some big figures. You cannot go very detailed in the comparison, but even if you compare dual earners, the gaps are clearly higher in Latin America than in developed countries. We could not find evidence for the other, for example, for Asian countries or for other developing countries, like a comparable evidence we couldn't find.
Yeah, I was going to ask that if you can compare with other regions in the world, but because they don't have analysis or
they have, for example, you have they have like particular analysis for specific regions or for a specific mm-hmm. time use survey or survey that collected data on time use, but it's not national data. So
okay, good, thanks. Okay, we don't have any further questions. Then we maybe can finish here. Thank you very much, Veronica. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you for your attention. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you, everybody, for joining. And we welcome you to join in 2 weeks for the next seminar, we have another question. I'm sorry.
Yes.
So do you know the situation in Argentina in relation to this research problem? Do you think a similar study could be carried out? Why has Argentina not been incorporated?
Yeah, what we did is that we incorporated all Latin American countries that had available microdata for this research. I mean, by available, I mean that they are available for researchers in the web pages of the national institutes. So I'm not sure about a time use surveys in Argentina. If they are doing, if they are doing these time use surveys and they are not available, maybe that is the case, but we didn't have access to that data. So that is why we didn't incorporate. There were other countries that we, for example, we had data for El Salvador and for, I think, for Nicaragua also, but we found very strange. In that case, it's related to Carmen's questions about the quality of the data. For El Salvador, for example, the sample is very small and the results are not consistent. So we decided to discard that. But what we try to do is that consider all the countries that had a relatively recent survey and the quality was appropriate. So in the case of Argentina, it's not available, but I'm not sure about if they have that service like incorporated in the set of service of the country. In Uruguay, for example, even with some delays and some problems, there are time use service even some, for example, in 2007, 2013, and now we are planning for this year or the next one another. So we have that with some periodicity, this information is collected.
Have a follow-up question on that, because this last year and this year, of course, information is going to be all messed up because of the COVID situation. So how's that going to impact the analysis? How do you think that's going to impact the analysis?
Well, that is a concern because it's been a problem in traditional household surveys. I mean, we have that problem, and other countries in Latin America are also having, because they are basically collecting the data by phone, so it's very different the kind of information. I think that in the specific case of Uruguay, the plan, I assume, must be to try to do the survey next year and presentially. I hope so, because we are waiting like a lot of years to do this. I think it would be reasonable to wait some months and wait until we can do it visiting the households. I hope so, yeah. Because it's very difficult to collect information, this kind of information, by phone. Because you have to answer a lot of things about how many minutes did you dedicate to this and that. It's difficult to collect this information because you need like a very patient person to respond the survey.
But in any case, it's I'm just thinking out loud that it would be also interesting to have information about this year's this situation and how housework is distributed, and especially
were done, you know, in many a general pattern of what is happening is like the gap between the gap in time dedicated to housework between men and women within the household has increased. In Uruguay, we have evidence, but in developed countries, there is a lot of evidence because both men and women incremented the time dedicated to housework due to the lockdowns and the presence of children in the household. But the increase in the case of women was higher, so the gap is even higher. And also, what is interesting is that for more educated households, this is not so. This is like the average, but in more educated households in some countries, the gap has become smaller because men have dedicated percentually more time to housework than women. So that is also like something good in the sense that it seems that some norms of some cultural patterns may be changing in some parts of the society. No?
There's hope. We have one extra question. What smart policy recommendations can be moved to reduce the inequality of this unpaid housework?
Okay, well, I mean, in terms of policies, I think that this is a difficult problem, because here we have like a part of the problem is clearly associated to the labor market, and then all the policies related to fostering female employment and female autonomy in economic terms, and facilitating the labor and domestic life are welcome. For example, all the policies that have to do with childcare, for example, services of childcare services for children, for very small children, or long days of schooling, all those things help. And then we have also a problem that has to do with social norms and with culture, and that is has also been in Latin America. I think that it's important. And so, not only the development of the labor markets will help to, you know, to equalize this and to lead to men dedicating more time to housework and, you know, to have something more equal within households, but also social norms. And there, I mean, I think there are things that can be done in terms of like government actions, in terms of putting this problem discussing this problem and beginning to put these things in the view of people, so that we can change those social norms. But that will take a lot of time. But meanwhile, the dynamization of the labor market and the incorporation of women is something that, I mean, it's like the endogenous problem is there, no? You have there the big problem for women, I mean, and the possibilities of having good quality and jobs and full-time jobs.
Okay, thank you. Now, okay. Yeah, maybe mm-hmm. We can finish now.
Okay.
Thank you, okay. Everybody, for joining. Thank you, Veronica, for presenting. And so in 2 weeks, we will have another of this seminar series. Ana Lucia Kasuf is going to present on child labor. So we welcome you to join in 2 weeks. Thanks.
Okay. Thanks. Bye.
Bye.